morning, everyone.
Good morning. Good morning.
This is one time I wish the service had gone really slowly. It's the first time I've been to here. And in the answer, I can tell you that I'm nervous. But it's good to be here. I've recovered from the shock of actually saying I would do this. And we're here this morning, and it's a good thing to be in the house of the Lord, and it's good to see you all here. One of the things that happens when I'm preaching is that there's a pre-sermon and then there's a sermon, but I get through it in about 1 hour, that's good. The pre-sermon. I'm thinking about a lot of things this morning. I'm thinking with Carter Hayward, who said, to say I love you means let the revolution begin. I'm thinking with Jesus, who said, who prayed, as we just prayed, your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And I think with a prayer, wondering, if you ever think about who you are in the scheme of things, and in the Matthean community, the community that produced this gospel according to Matthew, do we ever wonder who they were and what they were thinking about? And as I read the lesson for this morning and thought about the gospel of Matthew, I thought to invite you to hear this community through its gospel in the way that I tend to hear it. That as the stories are read, that we hear not the gentle Jesus, meek and mild perhaps. We don't have to hear him that way every time. That we perhaps not think about sacrifice for a moment. That we hear a community that begins its story with a narrative of birth and death. A narrative of coming into the world and becoming a refugee, a savior who becomes a refugee almost as soon as he's born. He's got to get out of town, out of Bethlehem, and move it with his parents to Egypt. A community that might be struck by the irony of such an action. That they belong to the heritage of a people who left Egypt seeking freedom and now are serving a master who, beginning life, had to leave home to go back to Egypt. That there is a kind of agony for a people, can we hear them? A people who have passed through the greatest horror, one of the early great horrors of the Jewish folk, the destruction of the temple. That they're living in the aftermath of the destruction of the temple. And they have got to ask the question, who are we? Not only are they living in the aftermath of the destruction of the temple, but they're living in a time when Israel has to seethe with identity questions. How are we going to be Jews when we don't have a temple? How are we going to be Jews when we don't have a land? How are we going to be Jews when the notion of the kingdom of heaven began as a release from captivity? The temple was a sign of that release, and here we are without it. What does it mean then to be part of the kingdom of heaven? And not only do they ask that question, but I invite you to muse with me as together we ask that question. What does it mean to be part of the kingdom of heaven? Let us go ahead and pray. May the words of my mouth, the meditation of all our hearts, be inspired by you, be acceptable to you, O God, our strength and our redeemer. Amen. And we're halfway there. In Jamaica, there is a community. A community that calls itself a congregation. It's an alternative community. It's a Rastafarian community. And they're Bobo-trans. And what they did over 25 years ago was to determine that Jamaica and Kingston, especially, were like Babylon. You know Kingston? Kingston is the capital of Jamaica, capital city. Decided that Kingston representing Jamaica was Babylon. And what you needed to do was to get out of Babylon and live your life in the way you thought the God you served wanted you to live that life. So what they did was to retreat to some hills just outside of Kingston and set up a community, not a commune, a community that called itself a congregation. And there they understood that where they lived was holy ground. This was God's utopia. Now let me be very clear. To set up that bit of property as their congregation, they eschewed working for anybody who was part of Babylon. So they had to develop their own industries. Broom making, mat making, corn planting, working and harvesting and living off of the land that they develop. They have prayers every day, sometimes throughout the day, and a worship service that happens in a really chapel shack. The point of it all is that for them, this place is where they work out their salvation. It's where they live justly and do justice to each other. It's the place from which they start their anti-culture protest and live out a subversive existence. And for them, this is their kingdom, their God space, their holy space. And they know that when you go into their chapel, which has a dirt floor, you've got to take off your shoes because the place on which you stand is holy ground. Why do I think about these people? You know, they live in a gap, in a place that sometimes can be described as between new and old. And as I thought about the passages that we read, these Kingdom of Heaven passages that end Matthew chapter 13, one verse in particular jumped out at me. It says, it's when Jesus says to his disciples, "Therefore, every scribe who has been trained for the kingdom of heaven is like the master of a household who brings out of his treasure what is new and what is old." When we think about these passages, these kingdom of heaven passages, the mustard seed, the yeast that becomes leaven, the finding of the pearl, the finding of the treasure, we're not thinking about new and old. We're thinking about exponential increase from very small beginnings. But here Jesus is talking about new and old. And when I ask you, who are you? How do you think of yourself in the scheme of things? I think about new and old. The tension in which we live. A space that we occupy between tradition and innovation, between conservation and invention, conservation and transformation. Do you ever feel the tug of that? Not knowing whether to stay with what you have always known or to move forward into something new? Those Bobo-trans, those good people of that community, were pretty brave, pretty bold, because Jamaicans didn't like them when they set up that commune. It was illegal. It was daring. It was standing against. But they were an oppressed people who chose to take their living into their own hands and not suffer the oppression of that. They moved from the old into a new that they defined. So here we are, in our time, in America, where the old and the new are at loggerheads every day of our lives. The religious conflict religious tension and religious debates are about whether we should follow the Christianity that brought America into the 1960s, or we should be finding a new way of a more inclusive, generous country than it might have been a long time ago. And we are caught in the tangles of indecision, trying to find our way through at times. And here we have Jesus speaking to us today about the new and the old, and living betwixt and between. You know, when Jesus said, "Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth," one wants to sing hallelujah. But then you stop, you pause, you listen to these stories, and you say to yourself, "What? Not so sure, not so." Let us go through these stories a little bit and think about them, because these are kingdom of heaven stories. This is a place we want to be. One of the things that Woolworth Dreads does do for us is to say to us that here on earth, the kingdom of heaven is that place where earth and heaven meet, where the ordinary meets the extra, and the extra meets the ordinary, and we become extraordinary. But extraordinary is not always a comfortable place. Let's think about this. So Jesus has this eschatological vision that he talks about, you know, end times, the last things. And he says, at that point in time, the net is going to be cast, and there would have been a division between the good things and the bad things. The good fish and the bad fish. The bad fish is going to be tossed out at the end of times. The kingdom of heaven then begins to look like a place where judgment is executed. But I want to cast a different kind of vision this morning. I want to invite you to think about the kingdom of heaven, that place, that point in our reality where kingdom and earth meet, cosmos and terrestrial meet. Not as a place, but as a space. An ideal space. A space where we can begin to think anew, to dream anew, to envisage the transformation of our world, the transformation of our lives, the transformation that moves from justice to injustice. Not because we're afraid of the end, but perchance because the process, as challenging as it is, has its own rewards right here. But I'm still thinking with this kingdom of heaven idea that I'm not always comfortable with, and I'm saying news around me. I'm not always comfortable with it. And one of my first points of discomfort is when I think about Jesus moving into the house in the story. You know, there are these two movements in the story. First, he starts telling about the kingdom of heaven while he's at the sea. Then he moves into a house. And when he moves into a house, the kingdom of heaven changes. Suddenly, it's like a treasure. It's like a pearl that you're going to find in some field, and you're going to sell everything that you have and gain this pearl. Now, you might think I'm silly. Why am I so afraid of gaining a pearl? Maybe for the same reason that I'm worried about somebody who finds a treasure in the field, goes and hides it, and then finds a way to make money out of the treasure. The kingdom of heaven at that point is beginning to sound very imperialistic, very capitalistic. For me, I'm a little uncomfortable about this. I'm uncomfortable about someone who goes into a field, finds a treasure, has no idea who owns it, and takes it for themselves. There is a problem here. I wish I had that thought, but I'm reassuring you I don't. But here we have it, and this is the kingdom of heaven. It sounds to me like when England went and captured India. It sounds like when England captured islands in the Caribbean. It sounds like when Spain fought with the USA over the Philippines. It sounds like what happened in Cuba. It sounds like what happened in parts of Russia. And I do get anxious. And I want to rescue Jesus' words from my anxieties and to turn it into something transformative and liberatory and good. I'm not sure that it wants all of that. I'm not sure that the Word of God wants any of us to rescue it. And so I'm going to invite you not to rescue it yet, but just to hang with the discomfort that reading it the way it is going might bring to us. And yet, to ponder, what is this treasure that people are willing to sacrifice so much for? What is this kingdom? Being an island girl, I said, let's go to the sea. Whether it's the Sea of Galilee or the Dead Sea, let's go to the sea. Because when I picture the sea, I don't know if it's the same experience Jesus had of the Sea of Galilee, which is like when he was doing these things, saying these teachings. But when I think about the sea, I think about nice lapping waves on white sand beaches. I think about ending up in Texas on a little island after Hurricane Sandy, at a table set with shells, seashells, and colored marbles, and streamers, and bits of trees, and finding a shell that looks just like one I would find on the beach in Jamaica. And the host says, yes, Sandy washed that up. We don't usually have these shells here. So I think about the sea as a place that laps the shores of Jamaica, laps the shores of Cuba, heads over to Florida, that's one angle, and another angle goes around South America and comes up the west coast of the United States and roars and tumbles there, but it's moving. That's the sea. And so it is interesting that in the house Jesus has possessions, but in the sea, by the sea, he starts talking about exponential growth. He starts talking about a mustard seed that becomes a tree. He talks about yeast that becomes leaven. But let me tell you something about that mustard seed before I go on. We all know by now that mustard seed is not the smallest of seeds. We also should know that the tree that it grows into is not a tree. It's a shrub. It's a tiny little shrub. What an imagination to think that this shrub is going to house all the birds of the air. What an imagination! You know those Bobojets who over 20 years ago went to their little commune? Do you know what I know about them? Because I took some tourists to the Bobojets. And when we were there with the Bobojets, you know, we were greeted by signs that said, this is black space. This is for black folk. We're going back to Ethiopia. That's what we saw. But you know who was greeting us? A Euro-Latino. Speaking Spanish. Because he had heard about the Bobojets in Brazil, where he had come from. He had brought his wife and his baby. And there was a woman who escorted us into the chapel. Hey, she was African American, living there in that. You see what I'm saying? What an imagination! When the Rastafarians began in the 1930s, we thought in Jamaica that we were going to wipe them out by criminalizing them. And I'm sure today, if I said Bob Marley, those are his beginnings. I don't know if I said Peter Tosh and Jimmy Cliff and Rita Marley, but if I said, yeah, there are some people in a certain generation in America who would know exactly what ska is, a form of Jamaican music, and the proponents of ska are largely Rastafarians. What a dream, what an imagination around a mustard seed bush. It sounds good, doesn't it? It sounds good. It sounds good when we're here in the United States of America and we're hearing about children entering the country illegally and we have to make decisions, hard decisions about how to deal with them. It sounds good when we think about the heritage of this country and know that we would like to protect the heritage of this country. It sounds good to have those twittering lovebirds in that tree. Sort of a tree. In that tree. Until you begin to ask, what kind of birds are in that tree? And you begin to see that in that tree there might be, hey, I don't know what kinds of birds they had in Israel, so pardon me if I Americanize Israel a little bit. But you're going to see hawks, falcons, partridges, ground doves, cardinals, robin redbreasts, who may not yet have heard that the lion should lie down with the lamb. They're going to be in that place together with those monopolistic, greedy, grabbing, cumulative, treasure-grabbing folk from the other verses. And then the kingdom of heaven is going to be like yeast. It's going to be like yeast. What a job. What a job. This is not a nice, homogenous, orthodox group of people that we have here. No, no. Can you imagine leavening such an unruly bunch? It sounds heroic, but it's quite a challenge. And the kingdom of heaven is that space, not a place where our imaginations are challenged to figure out how to live with these conflicting realities and find peace and find joy and bring about the new thing that might have come out of our old, but it's not quite what the old was. Challenges us to see how the old infuses anew, but does not remain the way it was. Challenges us to ask ourselves a question, who am I as these changes impact and afflict me? For certainly they will not leave me as I was. Do I have? Do I have the wherewithal? Does my country have the wherewithal? Can we alter history with this kingdom of heaven idea? It's hard to say yes, but we dare not say no. It's hard to say yes, but we dare not say no to the challenge of our times. To be that little seed, that little mustard tree, that shrub, that shows a Jamaican phrase. I'm sharing it with you. We're a little bit of the power. And that means that we're small, but we're strong. Think about the same word. If you do track and be. Small, but we can. Think about the little red engine. I think I can. I did. The kingdom of heaven, it's not a comfortable place. The kingdom of heaven, it's not an orthodox place. The kingdom of heaven, it is not a place where everything is sweet. It's a space where persons work out a new way of being in the midst of the changes that are around them. It's that space where we are called to imagine. And I pause and I look at you, my poor imaginers. Look at you in this congregation, this changing congregation, this congregation that says, here is a will to figure out what it means to live inside the change and to understand that change as a kingdom of heaven. Look at your heart, because when I look at you, I see the kingdom. When I look at you, I see the kingdom. When I look at you, I see the kingdom. When I look at you, I see the kingdom. When I look at us, I see the kingdom. Not comfortable, but growing. And I hear the words of Jesus, thy kingdom come, O God, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Spirit. In this space, we shall be space. And when we leave, on our feet, we will carry the kingdom of heaven with us, knowing that we are it. We are it. Not just the change we want to see, the change God wants to see. We're stumbling. Sometimes we're falcons, sometimes we're magpies. Sometimes we're partridges, and sometimes we're robin redbreasts. Sometimes we're cardinals, sometimes we're lions, sometimes we're lambs. Sometimes we're grubby capitalists. Sometimes we're grubby leftists. But together, we are the kingdom of heaven in all its grubbiness and in all its glory. Go forth. Be not afraid. The Lord is with you. It is God's kingdom.
Amen.